This being Stationeers means there's farming, there is even livestock and atmospheric simulation, and we also have electricity. And we certainly want to learn about that, huh? Therefore, I prepared a little foundation for us to build on. ...900 boxes. That is so much. Don't worry, there will be some electrical engineering and wiring information later. For now, I'm building the basic foundations for some decorative base in which all of that will take place. And so I just made the power plant that produces as much power as these cables can take. 100,000 watts. The maximum power that you can send through the strongest cable that Stationeers has is 100,000 watts. And here, like I said, we have 100,000 watts power coming in. And this is the small, well, smaller station battery. How fast can this thing be charged? One third is already charged. Pretty fast. Now let's try the same again for the large battery. That would take a while. Personal opinion, I think the large batteries are not really worth it, because the small ones take about the same amount of space if you stack two of them. They are much cheaper to make, and they almost have the same capacity. Now with that out of the way, we can finally start the cabling and electrical engineering tutorial with an airlock. We have the full unmitigated potential of the power plant available here, almost 70 megawatts. No consumers yet. Now, this is not an airlock tutorial, but at some point, electrical engineering and application meshes, and this is one of these cases. We take an area power controller, as you get it in the electrical supplies crate of your lander, and we place it inside the airlock. The purpose of the area power controller in the airlock is not so much to separate cable networks, about which I will talk later, but to make sure that we have some kind of power supply in the airlock, because if ever we have to get into our station and the airlock is not available, then we would have to break open a wall and all the gas would get lost, the plants would die if this were a proper station. So an airlock must always be functional. Now when we come from the outside into our station, we could just plug in our own battery and then the airlock would be operational so we could get indoors. You can see here, this is how fast, despite 100,000 watts, or actually infinitely many watts being available, this area power controller charges. It is charging with 1,000 watts. The amount of power that the batteries can output is basically limitless. And I'm not sure, but I think the power that this guy can output is also limitless. Of course, it's limited by the amount of power available and by the amount of power that a cable can withstand, but I think it doesn't have any throughput limitation, just like the batteries, the big ones and the small ones, do not have any throughput limitation. They will just output whatever is needed. This is also why you must not put too much load on one of those batteries or on an area power controller, because if it is too much load, one of the cables will blow. Now, as an early bit of information, you can limit the amount of power that can be output here by using a transformer. You can also protect cables from randomly blowing by placing a fuse, which will still blow, but it will blow in the designated place, so you won't be hunting for broken cables. Obviously, when you start building your station, you will not have this kind of power available, and you will not have heavy cables coming into your airlock, not at the very beginning. Instead, you'll be using wind turbines, for example. They don't work on the moon, and they don't even work in a wind tunnel like this. See? No output, no rotation, no cheating. But on moons and planets with atmosphere, they are a strong ally. The upright wind turbine is rather easily produced, and it produces about 200 watts when the winds are high, 800 watts even during a storm. That's nothing though compared to the tall wind turbines. During a storm they even produce 10,000 watts, but they only produce 500 watts peak during high winds. That's only 2.5 times what an upright wind turbine produces. But the costs of production are extremely high in comparison. Also, the footprint. It takes way more space. So these devices are meant for you to live from storm to storm, a strategic choice. Otherwise, wind should be obtained with these small ones. By the way, don't be too disappointed that the upright wind turbines don't work in a wind tunnel. We do have the turbine generator, which is relatively cheap to produce. Question is, how do you produce the wind? Well, during the day a planet is rather warm, during the night is rather cold. All you need is a corridor that is open, and so the atmosphere will breathe through that corridor. Naturally, it's going to be a chain of events that takes place slowly, and so air will be moving just by the apparent motion of the sun. Now, next to wind, there's of course also solar. This basic panel comes with your lander and can be constructed in the flat or angled version from the same kit. This is the same thing but reinforced. This one gets damaged in storms, but this one doesn't. Same difference here. If a solar panel is damaged by a storm, you can repair it afterwards. The basic one is easily produced and so is worth the money. Also, you can just put them in the glass room. That'll work. The heavy solar panel is not damaged by storm, but in my opinion it's not worth the price of admission. Look at all the things you need to invest to produce it. Instead, just building a glass room around non-reinforced solar panels makes more sense. Similar to the basic solar panel, the just solar panel will also be damaged by storm. It is relatively cheaply produced and most people use it. What's the difference between this solar panel and the basic one? Maybe you have noticed that this solar panel and this one is currently 100% efficient, almost producing 500 watts, while these ones, the angled ones, are producing much less. That's because these ones can be pointed at the sun directly. To point them at the sun, you need to use the wrench, as you will be told by the tooltip. This is for horizontal rotation. You can also fine-tune. And this is for vertical. It is worth noting that these solar panels come in two variations, dual and single. Dual means that the power port and the data port are separate instead of combined into one port. Same for this heavy version of the solar panel. By the way, the solar panels do not react to your flashlight or to the plant light. They only react to the sun. They can be obstructed by shadows. For example, shadows that they cast upon each other or that buildings cast upon them. And then there's of course this tiny solar panel that comes with your lander. It's rather powerful, actually a bit too powerful for my taste. It cannot really be angled at the sun, but you can place it at an angle on the soil. Sadly, this usually doesn't work because there's some bug in the implementation. The simulation thinks the solar panel is below ground here. Now it works. 65 watts. 100 watts. By the way, spoiler alert, the simulation of Stationeers isn't perfect. Here we produce 400 to almost 900 watts, because the pressure here is still fluctuating, if you just use more of these wind turbine walls. And the power we're putting in to make this happen, constant 500 watts. I'm sure if I would add a few more walls, the amount of power output overall would be even bigger. But when does this ever happen? When do we ever do such a thing? And if you ever find such an exploit, you'd be well advised not to use it. I mean, why do you play this? For the simulation or for ways to break it? The most popular beginner choice for the generation of electricity will of course be the solid fuel generator, also called coal generator, even though it doesn't generate coal. Let's put some coal in there, turn it on, 20 kilowatts, and this battery is charging just fine. Charcoal. Twenty kilowatts. There's not much information to be found about coal, but we know that charcoal holds less energy. It's even written here in the description, it contains less energy potential. I spawned a stack of 200, but burning it took it down to 179, while roughly the same duration took the 50 item coal stack down from 50 to 44. So yeah, this stuff burns much more quickly. Again, the potential is 20 kilowatts, but charging this battery only takes 1000 watts, even though it's not yet full, because the rate of charging is limited to 1 kilowatt. Similarly, down the line, if we try to charge this battery, this will also not be instant, it will also charge with maximum 1 kilowatt. So these cables will not burn out. These cables are rated for 5000 watts. Generally, you should not have area power controllers in a chain like this. In most situations, it makes more sense to have them in parallel, if it makes sense at all to have multiple of them. If you are outputting 20 kilowatts, a second one, right next to this one, would make sure that not 19,000 watts are lost, but only 18,000. The output of the solid fuel generator really is so high that we cannot reasonably make use of it with these few devices. A station battery, big or small, is a different story. It could be charged at virtually infinite speed and also be discharged at that speed. In other words, the cables can be killed if you don't take care. Case in point. Once I turn on the battery so that it would take in charge, the cable burns out, reliably. 20,000 watts is just too much. The situation is different with heavy cables. They can take through 100,000 watts. So the 20,000 watts currently delivered are not a problem. Again, realize the problem is the amount of load that you put on a cable. If we have infinite load on the cable but no power is coming in, that's no problem. But if the power is high enough and the load is high enough, then that will be the throughput. If both are more than 100,000, the cable will burn. And we can make this happen easily. Just watch. I added some room with some oxygen so we can hear, because the cable burning out makes a loud sound. Now we can also hear those wind turbines over there, which doesn't make sense, of course, because there's no gas between this box and the other, but the simulation of the game can only go so far. The sound calculation just considers, is the sound being made in a room that has gas, and is the sound being listened to in a room that has gas. That is why we're hearing those. Now let's turn on this thing and destroy the cable. Do not connect a battery's input to its own output. The water must always flow downstream. How do area power controllers react to the same scenario? Not good. Now about those airlock constructions. To be clear, the cable that goes into your APC doesn't have to be a heavy one. I just did it like this here because obviously I have infinite resources at my disposal. Now let's cable up the airlock. Right mouse button to build, mouse wheel to select the right cable. And you don't have to go through the motions of selecting all these complicated connectors. Just use the straight and curved cables, you will see. See here, the tooltip tells us merging requires wire cutters in other hand. So we only need the straight and curved cables. For the doors to be powered, we also need to turn the APC on. This now constantly draws 10 watts here and 10 watts here. You will usually have enough space in your airlock to place the devices in whatever location you wish, without getting into cable trouble. But sometimes you want to be efficient. You should consider, for example, making the airlock go around the corner. This might give you some more space on the floor. When you place your devices here on this side, where the power is coming in, then you need to lead your cables down here, to this place, not to this place. Your airlock needs to be on one network, else it will not work. This is one cable network, this is a device connecting two cable networks, and so this is another. The cable network analyzer is actually part of your landing gear. Let's use it. Here we can see all the connected devices. Large station batteries, the area power controller, and on the other side we see the composite door, the glass door, and again the same area power controller. we see how much power is being consumed, we see how much power is required, and we see the potential power. If the potential would be lower than what's required, the actual would be just as low as the potential. That would then count as a brownout. The console that we use in the airlock can also be used in other places with a different motherboard. It also comes in different variations. Single connection, double connection, just like the dual solar panel. So this has power and data, and this also has power and data, but in two ports. Then we have the diagonal screen, and then we have the LEDs in various sizes. I will put it down here. Then we need the gas sensor. An airlock chip and glass. This is the connection we need to make. Don't connect it with the input side of the APC, it needs to be on the same cable network as the rest of the airlock. Normally, you would have to bring two active vents into the mix so that the airlock is complete, but excuse me for using bigger ones. These are large powered vents, the most powerful vent in the game. They don't just suck from the place where they are, but also deep into the room and are made to fill or empty out full hangars. To get the power from the airlock, we use a little trick. We just cable it from the outside. Yes, even through the pipe that will be here, because this works. Now that the airlock is piped up, and indeed, the pipe goes through the cable just fine. We need to configure it. As per usual, I set the repressurization levels to zero for the fastest possible airlock with this console. Then I select the exterior door. That would be this one. Now the interior door, gas sensor. The vents are a bit more tricky. This one is for external. Is this one currently selected? No. Is this one selected? Yes, it's blocked. But that's the internal one, so I selected the wrong one. Okay. That's it, airlock completed. The console draws 50 watts and is not needed for normal airlock operations. If we'd be using active vents, we could just stick the disc in there to keep it around. But I'm using a shelf that is part of the kit locker. Also good for placing things in the airlock that you later want to take inside, or outside for that matter. Basically a physical to-do list. So now we know a bit about cable networks, about cable power, about batteries and their behavior, and about power generation. Let's think about this whole river concept, because we really have to let the water, the electricity flow from the top down. We start at power generation. Here we have some wind turbines on the moon, and here we have a coal burner. Both of these generate electricity. Here we are using heavy cables because we know they may be necessary. 800 watts per wind turbine during a storm, that would be 6400 watts, more than a small cable can survive. And since we have a battery here, that full power actually comes into play. So we need heavy cables here already, even though it's just these few wind turbines if there's a storm coming. By the way, here we can see the cable analyzer again. Actual 0 watts, nothing's coming in. The generator is off and the wind. Potential 0 watts, and the required is 3.6 megawatts. That's the amount of electricity that this battery can store. By the way, in the real world, we would be talking about joules, not about watts. Watts is joules per second. And you don't put flowing water in a glass of water, you put water in there. And so the water, that would be the joules. The flowing water, that's the watts. But calling it joules here would also not be correct, because we are talking joules per second. But the game has a simulation speed of half a second, and I think all respective numbers are also based upon that rhythm. Yeah, let's not look at it too closely. Now inside here, we have the output of the station battery that goes into two APCs, and these APCs meet in the middle. They're both an energy source. Is this a problem? No, it's not a problem. In the same way, you could also use multiple transformers in parallel. But the goal here is to do something else, and so I'm separating these two cables. These are wall heaters. Each of them consumes about 1000 watts. So that's 2, 4, 6, 8, 10,000 watts on a cable with 5000 watts capacity. What will happen? I want to hear that, so let's let in some air. Maybe some more. Yeah, that's good. And immediately we have an exploded carry here and one here. Again. So that reliably breaks some cables. Huh, interesting. In this case, it's still working. Here, a different cable exploded. Now we'd have to hunt for burnt out cables behind walls. Something that you don't want to have to do. Pretty useful. Even with these devices turned off and no batteries, we can still see how much power we're consuming. Because here we can see the potential. 2.1 kilowatts. 2.09. We have such a thing as cable fuses. Let's put one on this cable. I can now use the mouse wheel to select how strong it shall be. This one would blow at 1 kilowatts load and throughput, 5 kilowatts, 50 kilowatts. Oh, and 100 kilowatts. Let's use 5 kilowatts. The type of fuse that is used is indicated by the color. This is the smallest one. 1 kilowatt, green. Yellow, 5 kilowatts. Orange, 50 kilowatts. Obviously red for 100 kilowatts. Now let's see what happens if I turn on this circuit. Try again. The fuse blew. Only this one. Not 10 other cables, only this one. But what would happen if you put it back here? By the way, the fuse does not cause a new cable network. Back here we can still see the wall heater and the number is still 23614. 23609. So let's see what happens. So the fuse blew, but that didn't help because the cable network kept running. Yep. So yeah, the fuse is not just something that makes sure that you know where the cable will burn out, but you also have to place it strategically because placing it here doesn't help. So more cables will burn out. Let's try this again. Same outcome. The fuses need to be placed strategically. So how else can we solve this? Of course we could use heavy cables, though even heavy cables can be overloaded. Imagine 10 large wind turbines during a storm. That's 100,000 watts. Now one wind turbine more and then we have the cable overloaded. We can use transformers though. That's the small one. You can set it to a maximum load of 5,000 watts. The medium one, maximum 25,000 watts. And the large one, maximum 50,000 watts. Only exists in one form, but these two, which are part of the same kit, exist in two cosmetically mirrored forms. There. Now we have the two small transformers in play. You can see here, they are indeed mirrored. Nothing's happening, because they're set to 0 watts. Let's see what happens if we turn this up. Now the transformer pretends to do stuff, but the devices are not powered. What's happening? Is the room being heated? I'm not sure. 300 watts. As per usual, you can use the labeler to input the value directly. So that's what this looks like. No cable burnout, but is the room getting warmer? Apparently, for comparison. They are indeed heating. And the cables? They are safe. Though you need to keep something in mind. The transformer consumes 10 watts. So calculate that correctly. Well, looks safe, but our batteries are empty. I think we should start the waterfall from the top now. Okay, battery is full. Oh, what's that? The potential is growing, or rather, what's required. Battery is being discharged. With what rate? 20 watts. So the area power controller indeed itself uses power, like it says here. Next round of experiments. Currently, we have required 0. Required 10. The potential is decreasing because the battery is being discharged. And now what happens? Another cable blows. Why? Well, this network is safe, this network is safe, but both of these are hanging from this cable, and what they are drawing is too much. In principle, we could just add the next transformer right here and make sure that these can only draw 5000 watts. This cable would then be safe. Except this thing draws 50 watts. If I put the transformer here, we would be drawing 5050 watts. Complicated. This computer draws 200 watts. Also, as meaningless as these constructs really are, we can assume this is a station or a room or something, same here, and they just need some power, and you need to supply enough power for them to run. So the cable network up here needs to be able to sustain that. There, I replaced the cables with heavy ones. That just makes sense. See, I'm trying to give you a feeling of how you would have to cable this up when you make your station. For example, what comes from your station battery should generally already be a heavy cable. So what are we drawing here? Almost 10,000 watts. But our station battery is almost crying. I mean, it doesn't really care, but it is soon empty. Then we have to recharge it again with a coal burner. But this is an exceptional load, isn't it? Our station will use this sometimes, but usually not, right? And so for such situations, we should run on normal power supply, like wind or whatever, maybe solar. Solar is usually the best option. But in exceptional situations, we need to top up the battery automatically with a coal generator. There's only one piece of coal in there. Unless we use some chutes. So I just wrote a little program that shows us this flashing light when there's no more coal in there. Even plays a sound. But on that stupid moon, you can't hear that. Anyway, we can use this chute stack and that would be sufficient. We can of course go all out and have an entire silo here. Everything has been set up. Here's the coal burner. Here's the chute system. I can toss in things manually. And I can also just open the silo so it keeps stocking up here. Now this thing is turned off automatically. What's going on? Well, there's a chip here that checks if the power level here is below 10%. If so, it starts burning coal. Once the power level has reached 20%, it stops burning coal. And here we go, it's burning. Now it discharges down to 10 again, and then it turns on again. Let's take a short look at the source code. Pretty simple. We're just defining the solid fuel generator, the structure battery so I can check how full it is. I even have the speaker in here and the flashing light, but we can ignore those. They are not necessary for the ultimate recharge function. Here's my variable that says whether it should recharge. Then here we have the main loop, and I'm saying maybe run generator, maybe warn low coal. Let's ignore this, just look at maybe run Jenny. All we're doing is load the average battery charge ratio, branch if the battery charge ratio is less than 0.2 by two lines. If it is 0.2 or more, then we say run Jenny will be 0. Branch relative by two lines if R0, the ratio average of the batteries, is greater than or equal to 10%. If it is less than that, then this line will be executed, and so run Jenny will henceforth be 1. And then we just write the register, whatever value it may have, for example completely uncharged by the current situation, to the generator. Let's pay the station a visit. Almost 100% nitrogen and nice temperature. Even though the radioisotopic generators and the batteries have quite the waste heat, so the room is constantly heating up. What have I done to solve this? Out there we have a tank with liquid nitrogen, tons and tons and tons of it. And here we have an active liquid outlet. So when I click here, liquid nitrogen will be unleashed into the room with minus 230 degrees Celsius. And this thing is automatically controlled here. I'm loading the room's gas sensor temperature, turn it into Celsius because I like it. Then I'm saying if the temperature is greater than 25, I want a 1 in this register. And this 1, or 0, I then write to the on value of this active liquid outlet. This keeps the room at low temperature. I want to do an experiment. Here we have a full big station battery, here some 100 kilowatt cable, another full station battery. What happens if I connect the two and turn this guy on? It's pretty clear what's gonna happen. Cable burnout. Look at it, it's already discharged and this one's already charged. Ridiculous. And then the cable burned out. In one ping, in one game tick, the entire battery charged. Let's try this again. Nothing happened. Because nothing's flowing. Because this guy is full. Nothing's happening. Because there's now a transformer between, the biggest one that we have. Let's set it to the maximum possible value. It is now set to 50,000 watts. The battery is now charging with 50,000 watts. But that's not the full speed. So what happens if we have two transformers, both set to the maximum of 50,000? This should charge with 100,000 watts speed. There's still three generators that I didn't mention yet. Here's the portable generator. You usually have it on your lander. You need a fuel canister, and then you can charge a battery, for example. And it's a dirty beast. Hot, hot gas coming in, very polluted, and even volatiles in it. And this charges the battery. Battery is still red. Just how much power is coming out of this thing? We install a portables connector and then we find out. Nothing. Maybe it's all going to the battery? It is. 336 watts. Many devices in Stationeers exist as a portable version and as a structure that is installed solidly. The same applies to the gas generator. This is the gas fuel generator. Let's see what it outputs. Interestingly, it says here it requires an atmosphere of 20 kilopascal at 278k to 328k. And here's the output. I just wanted to see what it does. No atmosphere. Put the fuel bottle in. Oh, 12,000 watts. I mean, 11,900. Yeah, really seems to be the big brother of the guy we just saw anyway. And now it's just running. And now it isn't. What's going on? Is the bottle empty? It's not. I guess the environment isn't fine. The assumption is that this guy excretes a lot of heat and that it needs to be kept cool. A cool environment in which then this machine can run. I mean, look at this. This looks like, well, like a diesel engine, like a motor of a car. And, well, they can heat up to a certain degree, but they need to be cooled. If they get too hot, they don't really run right. And this is probably what this is. And finally, there's this 200-year-old invention by Robert Stirling. The Stirling engine. 8 kilowatts. The Stirling engine converts a thermal energy differential with a working gas into electricity. It requires cooling in the right environment, as it doesn't work. And it easily explodes if you do it wrong. The power plant cooling system works fine, but it keeps unleashing gas, and so no, the pressure is rather high. Let's make sure that this is solved automatically. Since we're on the moon, we can just afford to open the door. On Europa it's similar, when the outside is oxygen and we have no problem with oxygen in our station. Though here I would have a problem, I prefer the nitrogen that we have. Ah, whatever crap's in there too. The pressure will descend down to 100 kilopascals. Then there's some back and forth wafting afterwards. And then it would balance out. So, heat and pressure solved. You certainly know the small batteries from your tools, from your mining drill, from your tablet. They hold a charge of 0.036 megawatts, 36,000 watts. Actually, that should be joules, but okay, let's stick with what the game says. Then there's the large battery, which you certainly know from your own spacesuit. It holds a charge of 288 kilowatts, 0.288 megawatts or joules, which is exactly 8 times the amount that the small one can hold. Then, most of you probably heard of, but possibly never printed, the nuclear battery. It holds a charge of 2.3 megawatts, and this number shown on screen is exactly 8 times the charge that the large battery can hold. This is, by the way, exactly 64% of the amount of charge that the station battery can hold, with 3.6 megawatts. And it is 25.6% the charge that the large station battery can hold, with 9 megawatts. 25.6%, that's 1/4 of a large station battery you can carry in your pocket. Also not too well known are the wireless batteries, which can indeed be charged remotely. They hold much less charge than the normal batteries, and sadly it is not documented how much charge they actually hold. And probably known by the fewest, there is a disposable battery charger that you can carry with you. If you hold it in your hand and press the right mouse button, a progress bar will fill, and once it's full, battery will suddenly get a jolt. It will be recharged somewhat. The extra large wireless battery is actually not available in survival and can only be spawned in creative. Similar to the gas filters that never run out. Now, I made myself a little battery discharge room, wanna do some experiments. We have a row of wall heaters here which consume 1000 watts each. Currently though, they consume only 50 watts because they were in vacuum. That's why I put some air into this room. So let's see how the smallest battery of all holds up, the small wireless battery. Done, empty. The big wireless battery that you can also make. The large one that is only available in creative. The small one. It feels like the charge of this one is about as high as the charge of the big wireless battery. Now the large battery, which we have in our spacesuit. It seems to be discharging a lot slower than the extra large wireless battery. Let's compare. And finally, the nuclear battery, which we are not gonna wait out. So, how much electricity can we recharge? I'll give myself the large battery that we are used to having in our spacesuit. Now, let's take a look at the disposable battery charger. About 20%. How about the small battery?
Power critical.
By the factor of 8, this should definitely be full. And it is. Now what about the nuclear battery?
LOL.
To charge up a wireless battery, you need the power transmitter Omni. Currently is drawing 930 watts, because these two batteries are being charged. So in a few seconds this battery will be full. Let's see how much the charging changes. Will this one be charging up faster? About 300 watts less. I don't think it is charging faster. Oh, look at the extra large one go. Now, for a sense of scale, let's see what happens if we do this with 50,000 watts. Small wireless battery cell. Yep, empty. Big wireless battery cell. Empty. Battery. Empty. Large battery. Empty. Wireless battery cell extra large, which you cannot make in survival. Maybe 1/4 or 1/3. Now the nuclear battery. Degrees Celsius. Yep. But more interestingly, what's the reach of the Omni transmitter?
This is so completely crazy.
There. Omni transmitter and 20 by 20, which is 400 APCs with wireless batteries in them. Oh wait, for the experiment we first have to discharge them. Don't mind if I do. If a wireless battery is inside an area power controller, it will not be charged. The things I do for this stupid video. Okay, so I just picked out every single one of the 400 batteries. I want to see this. I wanted to see this for the longest time. What does this look like when the Omni transmitter charges the batteries? Because the ones closest to the transmitter get the most charge. And the furthest ones? Well, they won't be charged at all. I want to see that. Okay, it's time to do the grand experiment. So that's what this is then in the end. I guess these will also charge eventually, but it's not worth the wait, huh? And we're using 2000 watts. That explains why it took so very, very long. So let's analyze the outcome. We have 32 steps on the small grid, or 16 if you look here, because I left a gap each time. This means we have 7 volt boxes. This is as far as this reaches. And of course, it's strong here, it's weaker here, and it's rather boring over here, but still effective. So that's how close you would have to place these transmitters. One over here would be nice. I know, this is a radius problem. You could place it much further out, but you also want to get some throughput, right? So let's place it here then, I guess. 7 or 8 grids. 8 boxes. Every 8 box, one transmitter, you'll be fine. And of course, you're gonna burn through a lot of electricity. Personal note, building all of this by hand is crazy. Now let's take a look at consumption. How much electricity does this use? Here we have our power plant, 64 megawatt potential. Here we have our transformer. The power used here would be 10 watts for the door of the airlock, 10 watts for the other door of the airlock, and 10 watts for the Omni transmitter that's still active over there, but all batteries are now charged. Anyway, we don't care. Here we have a new power network, because there's a transformer in between, just like when there would be an area power controller. Potential 50 kilowatts, because that's the value this thing has been set to. The light is still low, because no power is being consumed. Omni transmitter turned on. And we have a consumption of 10 watts. 10 watts. That is being shown here. Now let's turn on the large battery charger. 10 watts. The small battery charger. 5 watts. But how much power does a battery charger use depending on how many batteries are in there? 500 watts. 1000 watts. Okay, so it actually charges 500 watts per battery. That is something to be considered. This is already half of what the weak cables can hold. Half and a little bit more. So if you have 2 battery chargers fully stocked, your cables will already blow. Now let's see if that's different for nuclear batteries. It's not. Same load. Nice light show. What about the small battery charger? ?400 watts. I didn't know this at all. The small battery charger charges more slowly. 400 watts per battery instead of 500. Yep. So about the Omni transmitter for wireless batteries. 10 watts. One wireless battery. A big one. 300 watts. Yep, that's about the distance we measured earlier. How about 2? 600 watts. Now 3. 900 watts. 5. 1500. 10. Should be 3000, right? But it's not. It tops out at 2000. 7. 2000. 6. 1800. So you get the maximum out of this guy if you use 7 batteries, but only 6 will be charged properly. Of course, as we've seen, you can charge as many batteries as you want, you just have to invest a ton of time. Hardly ever used in my experience, the wireless transmitter. It is a directional power transmitter that sends electricity over vast distances. There must not be any obstructions though. I just observed and reported a bug. I placed an obstruction and the receiver was still receiving. I turned the receiver off and on, then it was no longer receiving. But the opposite, removing obstructions, will update the reception. What's interesting is that even though we're consuming 100 watts, the sender only causes 100 watts to be consumed, even though every little battery charger already consumes waste electricity when it's not even doing anything. Now, I placed another receiver further down, it's not receiving anything. Let's remove this one and see what happens. We can already see the light in the distance. ...2.43 kilowatts. How much power are we consuming on the sender side? ...100 watts. Question is, what's the reception potential? Depending on distance. Of course we have to adjust its direction. Still nothing. This one's still receiving. I will turn it off. Now it does not receive anything. Let's go back. So, the logic is, the removal of an obstruction will update the receivers. Placing a new obstruction will not update the receivers. How much power are we getting? 4.95 kilowatts. So the further out it is, the lower the maximum possible reception. Where's the update? There it is. Took a while. I tried placing an iron window here. The receiver was still lit. When I went there and turned it off and on, it stayed off. I replaced the iron window with a composite window shutter. During the replacement, the light turned on, because the path was no longer obstructed. Afterwards, though it was obstructed, the light did not turn off. I flew over there, turned it off and on, then it was off. I closed the shutter, of course, same result. I opened the shutter, same result. So, creating an obstruction does not update this. But removing obstructions does update this. And any obstruction works. A solid steel frame, an iron window, window shutters, even if they're open. The path must be completely empty, as long as it's wall-like obstructions. A furnace doesn't count. Two furnaces, three, doesn't matter. The furnaces are not in the way. Then again, I just created the obstruction. No power. The furnaces are indeed in the way? Only one way to find out. Now the light is on. God damn it, what's the principle here? I don't get it. Very, very iffy. So, just what is the reach of this? 0.1 watts at 500 meters. Alright, I think we know enough about these guys now. Primarily that they're somewhat buggy. An electrical engineering overview wouldn't be complete without a look at how desk appliances are wired up. So we have various tables, not all of them are electrified, but we need an electrified table to use the microwave. So one of these will suffice. Then we place the microwave on the table, use the wrench, and now it can be used. Remember to only put one potato in there. Anything else doesn't work. And that's it. That concludes the Stationeers Power Systems overview.